to talk about web scalability and the massive amounts of fun that we had running a very large charity campaign website late last year. So, who are we? We're a managed hosting company based out of Sydney. We do loads of stuff, everything from logistics applications to websites, desktop applications, you name it, we host it. And we do all that out of Global Switch in Sydney, which is a pretty nice big data center. So, in 2007, we got approached by Dollar Charity. Unfortunately, I didn't manage to get permission in time to mention their name, but c'est la vie. Sorry, guys, one sec. Right, so Dollar Charity are based in Australia. They're relatively young, and they're very high profile. They're very campaign-oriented. One annual campaign is the major source of all their income. If that campaign fails, they don't have any money. They can't fund anything for that entire year. The campaign runs for 4 weeks, officially. But really, it's more like six. The website certainly stays up for about 6 months. And you can continue to make donations. But officially, sign-ups are only open for that 4 to 6 week period. There's a massive media campaign associated with it. There are celebrity appearances, interviews, stories, that sort of stuff. And all of that has pretty interesting effects on the traffic profile. As I said, they're Australia-based, but they're expanding worldwide. So there are a couple of countries, the US and the UK, that they've had pretty big media blitzes in this year. And all of the processing, including the call center, the statistics, the financial reporting, and the payment processing happens over the website. And the last 3 years, they've had 50% year-on-year growth. So, a bit of history. In 2006, that was the first time the campaign was run. Bulletproof wasn't involved at all. And the website peaked at around 200,000 page impressions on the busiest day. So 200,000 users. So they were hosting with Dollar Hosting Company. And Dollar Hosting Company didn't go so well. They switched off the website when the hosting company's available resources started running out. So they ran out of bandwidth, CPU, and to preserve the rest of their customer base, they just switched them off. So there was a 48-hour outage over this 4 to 6 week period whilst they moved to in-house servers that were hosted by the web developer. But it was still a very successful campaign. During day, yeah. And this was just in Australia. So they weren't really doing much of anything overseas at that point. And over the course of the campaign, they raised just over $8 million. So, 2007. Following the spectacular success of the 2006 campaign and its wonderful hosting environment, we got the chance to get involved and provide the infrastructure. We knew it was a pretty big site. So, I mean, 200,000 page impressions and $8 million, that's nothing to sneeze at least in the Australian market. But we didn't quite realise what we were up for. We didn't do a lot of prep work. There was no load testing. The developers pretty much just wanted to suck it and see. So as a consequence of that, there was no caching and there was very little optimization. So how bad could it really be? I mean, it's an Australian website. It's not like we're doing Facebook levels of traffic here. This is the graph of the primary database server. So that's actually load average times 100. So that's a peak load of 80. And that was actual transactional load. That wasn't the app stuffing up. That was people trying to make donations. So that was not so awesome. Times 10. Yeah, so 80.0 is the actual load average at the top there. Sorry, it's our wonky MRTG graphs. So they peaked at 15 virtual machines. So this was all running on our dedicated VMware farm. Served a maximum of about 450,000 page impressions, which was pretty much that last spike there. What 450,000 users does to your site. It still wasn't a lot of traffic. It was 14.51 megabits. And as you can see, the database server was the problem. The database server was running Postgres with three slaves and one master. But it was the write load that just didn't cope. Over the course of the campaign, we managed to keep it up and only had about 2 hours of downtime, I think. Is that right? Yeah. So, July this last year, we thought we'd think about that one a little bit more. We got told pretty early on that we were to expect between 2 and 3 times the traffic. And that there's not much money for reworking the app. So we needed to solve the problems in the infrastructure. So we sat down with the web developers and we started thinking about what the parameters for the app were going to be and the infrastructure. So downtime is expensive. And when you're running a 4-week campaign and expecting millions of dollars of donations, it's really expensive, particularly if the people don't come back and make their donations later. So we worked it out, and it works out for every minute of downtime. In the worst case scenario, we're losing $3,000 to $5,000 a minute. So we also assumed that following 2006 and 2007's stellar records, something's going to break. It was also a sort of core assumption there that the user experience was equivalent to the latency in accessing the website. That was, I guess, really a key assumption for us, particularly in launching the international sites. It's one thing for users in Australia or New Zealand to experience, a 200 millisecond or 400 millisecond round trip to retrieve an object in a web page. In the US, it's just not acceptable. So we spent a lot of time looking at eliminating single points of failure, making it really easy to add resources in very short amounts of time. So provisioning new machines and putting them into the cluster in under an hour. That was the goal at least. So that we could slow that scaling curve as much as possible. So in order to deal with the latency, we thought about several things. We thought about putting a cluster in the States, we thought about putting a cluster in the UK, and doing all the payment processing and all that shit over there. But it's just too expensive. It's hideously expensive when it gets down to it, when you want to launch a new hosting environment in a foreign country. So we figured we'd go the cheap route. And the cheap route was pushing the content as close as possible to the user using reverse proxies as a poor man's CDN. We then use GeoDNS to get the users to the proxy node that was closest to them. So we thought again about what could go wrong, and well, we tried our best. We thought again about the budget and what we could do within that, and we decided that the best option would be to pick the low-hanging fruit and try and just eliminate the problems that we could test. So, pimp my cluster. Absolutely everything had to be redundant. No single points of failure. We knew that something was going to go wrong. It seemed inevitable after the previous 2 years' experience. So we used a lot of replication, and we used a lot of caching, but only where caching makes sense. It didn't make a whole lot of sense to cache the majority of the website. In fact, the developers argued really strongly against that because it's very user-focused. And the user experience was what they felt, the stickiness was what they felt drew in the users and encouraged them to donate more money. So that was kind of tricky. It really sort of only left us with a few options there, one of which being throwing more hardware at the problem. We also paid a lot of attention to having automated failover. So using KeepAlifeD, Heartbeat, that sort of stuff. Because I really didn't want to get paged at 3 a.m. and have to go and fail the website over. Another key part of that was having lots of instrumentation. So lots of monitoring, lots of triggers inside the app going, yeah, your shit's broken, go fix it. So we started with the premise that we needed to cluster stuff. And pretty quickly, it became very obvious that active-active, at least for a lot of stuff, like file serving, databases, that sort of stuff, it's too freaking hard. So, I mean, it almost always requires special code, loads of hardware, or both. Active-passive is a much easier option. And if you can live with 15 seconds of downtime during failover, then it's all good. So, I don't know how many people are familiar with typical sort of clustering models, but there you go, active passive, replicate between a couple of servers, have a floating IRP out the front, and some sort of automatic failover method to switch to the passive node if something goes bang. So that was pretty straightforward. We used that model a lot to implement the database. So using MySQL, we did a master-master replica ring. Unfortunately, MySQL doesn't have any conflict resolution, so it's really bad if you write to the standby database server. DRBD was awesome. We didn't have a lot of requirement for serving files. It was just sort of users uploading some photos and a bunch of static content. That was only about 30 gigs in total. So DRBD with NFS out the front was plenty. Worked great. Apart from when it didn't, which we'll get to. Squid. It's awesome. Caching content as it comes out of the application really helps performance by both reducing the load on the app cluster and, of course, what we talked about earlier, which is moving the content closer to the user. And that's really what it's all about. I can't stress that enough. If you reduce that latency and get that content closer to the user, your users are going to have a better experience. And in our case, at least, they're going to give us more money. So we use Squid after looking at a bunch of different options. You know, Nginx and all the standard sort of bits and pieces out there in that little Web 2.0 world. But everything else, when it came down to it, at the end of the day, it seemed half-baked. So Squid was really, really awesome. It worked really well. Very high performance, very low load. So yeah, it was great. It was probably the one piece of the infrastructure that just worked flawlessly. So this is our poor man's CDN. So using geographic DNS records, so we just had some data from MaxMind that we grabbed and we mapped it to our three different nodes, the main cluster in Sydney, one in the UK and one in the US. We could just redirect the user whenever they requested the www URL to the closest site. By tunneling the traffic back through a VPN, we were able to terminate SSL at the proxy service, which was a really big advantage given that obviously all our donations were going over SSL. Yeah, so we cached all the content on the secure site, which turned out to be huge. It reduced page load times in the US and the UK by about 80%. But we learned pretty quickly that it was kind of important to set the content in expiry headers. Yeah, there was some definite head scratching at the start of the campaign going, why didn't that speed up as we'd hoped? Oh, right. Oh, okay. You guys have set the content expiry in the app to 1980. That'll be great. Could possibly go wrong. So we actually ended up working around the application a little bit there, again, because we just didn't have the resources to do a whole lot of optimization in the app by implementing Apache's mod expires, which is just awesome. Yeah, regex match and just go set your content expiry. So after we'd come up with the design and we'd sort of implemented it, the plan was that we'd test and then we'd do some optimizations and then we'd test again. And the theory being that because we were so limited in the development funds for the optimization, we'd implement the infrastructure as best we could and then use load testing to tell us where the biggest site bottlenecks were. So this let us pick the lowest hanging fruit and try and optimize the really critical stuff. Unfortunately, all of the load testing tools we tried sucked. So we basically ended up hitting a really large list of URLs that we're pulling out of the Apache logs from the development servers with a tool called Siege, which for those of you who haven't heard of it, is basically just Apache Bench on steroids. That worked pretty well. Certainly, I think through the start of the campaign, we didn't have any particular problems. We tested those code paths pretty well. But unfortunately, that wasn't the entire case. So configuration management, it's a reasonably new idea, I think, for those of us that weren't burnt by CF Engine, at least. And I think it's awesome. It's a really good way to ensure that your infrastructure is consistent and provably so. I don't really care what tool you use. My tool of choice is Puppet. But it's really important either way. Just do it. It takes a lot more time to set up an environment in a configuration management system, depending on how much of a guru you are. But it really can be very helpful. It certainly would have helped us during the testing process to be able to go back and apply a configuration, test it, make some changes to the configuration, test it again, and then to be able to look in the revision control system and see what we changed and have that nice sort of history of what was going on there. It certainly would have also helped during problem analysis when the shit hit the fan. It's definitely also the best tool that you have to guarantee that one node is the same as the next node, which is very, very helpful when you're trying to debug cluster problems. Unfortunately, I lost that argument. The account manager and my boss sort of went, we don't have time to do that. So I didn't get to use it. So along we come to September 2008, and we had infrastructure and we tested it to some degree. And we didn't get all the testing that we wanted done because, well, the tool sucked and we couldn't really get a complete URL list. GeoDNS wasn't ready yet, but the commercial provider that we'd elected to go with changed their commercials on us, sold us the wrong product, and then elected to offer us a bill that was 10 times the original agreement. So we told them to piss off, and we rolled our own. There's a really nice DNS package called PowerDNS. It's an authoritative-only DNS server. It's packaged in Ubuntu and Debian and all that jazz. It's got a GeoIP backend. So we just wrote a Perl script to throw in the MaxMind data, sort of munged in the right way to work with PowerDNS and our particular geographic setup with the proxy service. So we went live. And before we went live, we were pretty happy with the infrastructure. But inevitably, shit goes wrong. Along the line, someone managed to drop the wrong database. Oops. Restored that from backups pretty quickly. Again, this is where configuration management would have been great. Then we hit a DRB debug that resulted in a split brain. So we ended up rolling our own packages and upgrading. But we finally got the site live. So we were pretty stoked at the end of a 30-hour weekend. Unfortunately, this dude Murphy, he was a bit of an optimist. At 1:45 a.m. on the 22nd of September, so 7 days after we'd taken the site live, a single CPU core on the secondary database server started introducing errors. So processes started dying, and they were dying silently. MySQL was one of the victims, and wonderful support staff was just like, "Oh, MySQL's not running. Is that even live? What are you talking about?" So I didn't get a phone call till about 8 a.m. the next morning. And I was like, shit, what are you doing? Come on. So we got the CPU replaced. But 2 days later, single-bit memory errors started appearing in the logs. So we got the RAM replaced. So things sort of chugged along for a while. That was great. Was working really well. I was only spending about 4 hours a day on the project, so I was kind of happy about that, being able to get some other stuff done. 11 days after that, however, guest VMs started dying on one of the ASX servers. And they were dying. Guests, so VMs. They were dying with memory corruption errors. I was thinking, this is starting to sound a bit familiar. The ESX servers were running on the same model of server. So we had five of these servers from this particular vendor. And two were database servers and three were ESX servers. So we got the memory replaced in that host as well. And we chugged on for another 3 days or so. And then a second ESX host crashed with memory errors. We were like, this is starting to get a bit suspicious. So we replaced the DIMMs in that one. Only the errors started reoccurring. With three of the five servers out of the same batch failing, it was starting to smell pretty wrong. So I'm sure you can all read. We were the first users in the world to experience a general incompatibility between this type of server and a specific batch. It was actually a batch manufactured over a week by Micron in Puerto Rico. So, I mean, I guess they churn out a lot of 4 gig DIMMs in a week, but it's probably not statistically significant compared to the rest of the DIMMs they chuck out. So, working with the vendor, it took us about 3 weeks of testing to determine that was the root cause. In the meantime, we were able to supplement the existing systems with some loaner hardware, which the vendor very kindly gave to us for a couple of months, which sort of got us out of the woods. And I guess that's an important lesson there, is to have a really good working relationship with your vendor. They were able to join us twice a day for a phone conference during that three-week period, give us the loaner hardware, and they actually had two of their senior engineers working on this problem full-time in Sydney, trying to figure out what the hell was going on. So at one point during this, we were down to a single ESX server and a single database server. So all of that carefully planned redundancy out the window. Yeah, well, that's right, but you know. So we were running on this single ESX server and a single database server, and one of the Sun. Hang on, I wasn't supposed to mention the vendor anyway. And my iPhone doesn't like it when I receive SMSs in the middle of a presentation. So one of the vendor engineers logged into the management card on the server and ran a non-intrusive diagnostic command, which we were assured repeatedly over about three phone conferences that was completely non-intrusive, didn't do anything at all. The ESX server kernel panicked. Turns out that this non-intrusive diagnostic command, I don't know what sort of crazy code path they've got going on there in the hardware, but it steals the CPUs off the running OS and runs a whole diag and prints out the contents of the registers and that sort of shit. This senior engineer forgot to run the command that gives the CPUs back. So understandably the OS wasn't particularly happy with that. And the machine rebooted. So thankfully though, the site was back up and running again after about 10 minutes. Over the course of about a week, we very carefully replaced all of the DIMMs in the servers. So these boxes had 56 gigs of RAM at that point. So that's a fair number of DIMMs. And we sort of did that very carefully by doing the dance of taking one system down and replacing its memory and running memory tests over it and then moving on to the next one. So yeah, our support team didn't get a whole lot of sleep that week. One of the things that came out of that process and later on some of the performance issues with the site that we were dealing with is that a lot of the guys that we dealt with got very superstitious about the problems that we were having. They were like, oh no, you can't touch that server. You know, stuff's going to break. Random shit's going to break over here and over there and up there and, you know, down there. But I didn't think that was a very good approach. I don't think it really helps anyone to start talking about all the things that could possibly go wrong and, you know, not offer any evidence as to why they might go wrong. So I tried to clamp down on that as much as possible, but it was still definitely there, and that's something that we still need to deal with in the culture of our organization. And I think a lot of the organizations that we deal with have this same issue. When shit starts breaking and people aren't particularly sure why, they can't see the reasons for it, they tend to get superstitious about making any changes, and I don't think that's helpful. I don't think there's an easy answer. It's hard when you get spooked by multiple failures, particularly, you know, when one system over here fails, it doesn't seem related to another failure over there, but maybe it is, who knows. But I think the ultimate answer is to return to the evidence and the science of system administration, if I can sort of say science around system administration, but, you know, at least some of us have computer science backgrounds, I'd hope. So, I mean, really, it's all about returning to the monitoring and the instrumentation that you've got in your app and your infrastructure, and looking at what that says and what happened when it went wrong. And if there's nothing in there to indicate why something went wrong or when something went wrong, then you probably haven't got enough instrumentation. So, moving on a bit, this was one of the favorite arguments during the campaign. You can save money by running stage on the production infrastructure. What could possibly go wrong, right? In a cost-constrained environment, and I've been in a few, it always seems like a good idea to do this. Particularly when you start thinking about trying to keep the two environments in sync. It's nothing, though, compared to the stress and the pain of live data accidentally getting written to the stage database. And don't say it won't happen, because it happened to us. One of the lead developers managed to switch the production website when he was playing around with the site configuration to talk to the stage database. So we had, I think, about an hour's worth of donations written to the stage database, which was just tops. I was thrilled. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. So we had a staging environment where we'd we had three environments: development, stage, and production. So the developers would write code in dev. They'd push it to stage. They'd do user acceptance testing, that sort of stuff. We'd play around. We'd see how it ran on the infrastructure. And then it'd get pushed to prod, which is it's a really sensible and sane way to write code, unless, of course, your stage environment runs on the production infrastructure. And that's when it burns you. The other thing around that was just making sure that all of the support team knew how to clear the caches on the proxies, because, of course, when they switched the app to the stage DB, they managed to switch various bits and pieces of the app to hit the stage code path as well. And so all of that content got cached, which was just great. So yeah, make sure you and your team know how to clear any caches that are involved. So memcached, squid, whatever. Just save yourself some pain and write some scripts to clear it. Yeah. So stop with the kitten killing, please. Again, with the configuration management. It totally would have helped us during that problem. It really would have been nice if they let me implement it, but c'est la vie. Next year. It really is a great way of minimizing the pain of keeping stage in sync with production. And it also helps you reliably replicate any fixes or changes that you might make in stage to help the code run better. After you've completed testing, you might want to replicate those into production. I think I mentioned that before. Inevitably, though, throughout all of this, you're going to miss something, particularly with this testing procedure that we had, where we were sort of, I guess, a little bit more evolved than suck it and see. But we had a list of about 1,200 URLs, and we couldn't guarantee that we were hitting all the paths in the app, because every time we asked the developers, they were just like, URLs, what URLs? I don't know anything about new URLs. Test data, we don't need any test data. It'll be good. It all works great. I've installed my new code on the production servers, and away we go. And then you hit something like this. So this was a query that at least initially, and then again at the end of the campaign, because someone turned something off, wasn't getting cached. And it was also on a really popular page. So there was a page in there that sort of totaled up all the donations and then ordered it by country. As it turns out, towards the end of the campaign, people start getting really competitive and trying to beat the country next door. So, there were a few people looking at this page. It as you can see, it's got a nice little left join in there and a couple of sums, and there you go. Just great. So it examines 5 million rows. And the worst time it took to execute, which is one that I happened to look at last night. Yeah, that's a long time to be waiting for your web page to return. Yeah, typically. It depends whether you're receiving data, though. So, yeah. Typically, Apache wouldn't time out. The user would just, be sitting there with the loading bar of death. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, they sort of stack on top of each other. That's why we ended up with the 794 seconds. Typically, the response time when the site was empty was around about 180 seconds. Still not awesome, particularly given that little focus that I mentioned earlier on latency. Virtualization. It really helped with problems like that. I mean, not so much with a query like this. You really need to get someone to actually sit down and slap them around a bit to get them to fix up their SQL and to get it cached. Which is what we did in the end. They reduced that to about 5 lines of SQL, which still kind of seemed a lot to me to just generate a summary of all the donations in the database. But whatever. So we cached that in Memcached as well, and just put a little note on the website that it was only refreshed every 10 minutes. Which I don't know. I spent a lot of time arguing with the developers about that. About whether the users would really care if it was only updated every 10 minutes versus the cost of the infrastructure to actually make that query run, which was kind of significant. Virtualization. I love it. It's awesome. Being able to spin up new VMs to ease an infrastructure hotspot is a lifesaver. We actually had a hybrid farm, which is going to be one of my next points. So we ran the database servers on these two physical nodes. And when, of course, the shit hit the fan with the RAM, we had physical app servers and physical proxies and stuff as well. Typically speaking, because we were only doing single CPU VMs, that was just it's an interesting limitation of scheduling algorithms in virtualization stuff. It's cheaper to run lots of single CPU VMs or lots of multi-CPU VMs, but you can't mix the two. Otherwise, you suffer all sorts of interesting performance issues. It turned out that the sort of dual CPU or dual core CPU machines that we had running the app were probably about 3 times more efficient, did about 3 times more traffic than a single VM, but because we were able to really pack the VMs in there and to target them at the specific parts of the infrastructure that were suffering on any given day. It was actually a lot better, we found, just running virtual machines. Obviously, for the stuff that can't scale horizontally, so you can't just add more servers to make it faster, that's not a real good solution. So that's where we ended up with the physical servers for the databases, which were huge. They were 8 cores and 32 gigs of RAM, or 36 gigs of RAM, I think they were, which worked pretty well with MySQL. So we looked pretty carefully at the workload to distribute that between physical and virtual machines. As I was saying, make sure you don't do things that can only scale vertically on VMs unless you can throw really large VMs at the problem, which is inevitably going to be less efficient than throwing physical hardware at it. Virtualization plus a little bit of hardware works really well. So how am I going for time here?
5 minutes.
Awesome. So at the end of this, I sort of was reflecting back on the project. And scalability, as much effort as we put into the systems engineering, isn't about systems engineering. It's not about software engineering. It's about user experience. Every single thing that we did was about improving the user experience, whether it was latency, whether it was, you know, doing weird sort of out-of-the-box stuff like looking at the website and going, wow, you guys are downloading, I've sourced way too many files in that. How about we clag them all together and get it running that way to get around the browser connection limitations. So I guess the point was that it's easy to forget that. It's easy to get wrapped up in, I guess, either the systems engineering or the software engineering, depending on which side of the fence you're sitting on, or whether you're, in fact, straddling it. So don't spend too much time on either. It might be really cool to play around with awesome systems and clustering and distributed file systems and all sorts of crazy crack shit that you might want to look at. And it might be really cool to look at things like Memcached and think about doing really silly things like storing your sessions in it. But ultimately, when it comes down to it, it's about the user experience, and you need to try and remember that. So, results. 2008, we had unplanned downtime of 1 hour over the 6 weeks, which is kind of shit, really. But given everything that went wrong, not too bad. Especially given the pain involved in some of the application changes and some of the silly things the developers did on the stage/production infrastructure. Again, we didn't see a massive amount of traffic. I mean, it was a fair bit for an Australian site. But the number of page impressions we were serving for that was huge. We was it 600,000 or 800,000? Something like that. Yeah, 600,000 or 800,000 page impressions on the biggest day, which was 21 megabits. The campaign itself, we got around about 500,000 donations by the end of the month, and raised $25 million. So that was a pretty impressive result. The charity, Dollar Charity, was incredibly happy with that. Just absolutely stoked. And I mean, that's going to allow them to get on and do some pretty amazing stuff through 2009. Involved with their mission and all that. I'd love to mention something about what they do, but yeah. So this was just a pretty amusing anecdote that came out of the campaign. It turns out that when the Melbourne Cup runs, that's a pretty significant bandwidth dip. It really does stop the country. So for those of you that aren't Australian or New Zealanders, the Melbourne Cup is a horse race. Runs once a year, and it's the biggest horse race in Australia, and it's so most people usually use it as a great excuse to get pissed and bet on the horses, and it's sort of known by the tagline as the race that stops a nation, because everyone sort of stops and watches TV, or if they're lucky enough, makes it to the races. So yeah, it also stops web traffic. So goodness only knows what the Okay. Sorry guys. So I just wanted to say a quick thank you before we go to those people up there. You know who you are. Miguel is my awesome counterpart at the web development company. Andre, who put up with me writing my slides while he was trying to sleep last night. Ian, who did our database optimization. He's a great DBA. John Felito, who was sort of my plan B every time I ran out of sleep. And of course, the team at Bulletproof. So thanks, guys.